Okay, so OpenAI has released GPT-4o Mini. So over the past few months, certainly OpenAI has taken a hit with a lot of people moving to the small models of things like Claude 3.0 Haiku and Gemini 1.5 Flash. And the main reason that people moved was because those models were just so, efficient, but also more importantly, they were just so cheap. So it seems today that OpenAI has basically dropped a competitor, which seems to be beating a lot of these models, called GPT-4o Mini. So the idea here is this is a smaller version of a GPT-4. Now, of course, they don't tell us anything about the actual size. They just tell us what it can do and the costs and stuff like that. Let's go quickly through some of the things. So they're calling this the most cost-efficient small model. Now, I think even just that is interesting. This is probably not the smallest model that they've served in the past, but it's the model that they've optimized for charging the least amount. So I think the key thing here is basically the cost. So this is going to cost you 15 cents per million input tokens and 60 cents per million output tokens. So that's substantially cheaper than Gemini 1.5 Flash and than Haiku. So we have Haiku coming in at 25 cents per million input, 125 per million output. So already GPT-4 Mini is basically half the cost of Haiku for output tokens. Not to mention that it's also 60% cheaper than GPT-3.5 in here. So certainly OpenAI is struck back with this model of being able to get people back into their ecosystem using a cheap, and it looks like a very good model as well. So they're also advertising that the latency is much lower and the benchmarks are outperforming the other models. So if we look here, we can see that comparing GPT-4o Mini, it seems to be consistently beating Gemini Flash, which is consistently beating Claude Haiku for a lot of these benchmarks. Now, I find it interesting that there are some benchmarks that they've left off, the GSM 8K and stuff like that. I'm wondering, is that because we know that GPT-4 originally trained on some of that data? So I'm not sure if that's the reason why they're doing it, or they've just replaced this with benchmarks that favor them a lot more, like the math benchmark in here. Now, they've very conveniently also included GPT-4o in here to try and dissuade you that, hey, you should occasionally still pay for the big model and the more, expensive model. But they are clearly trying to show here that this model, on the whole, according to these benchmarks, seems to be beating Gemini Flash and Haiku. Although I do notice that one of these, Gemini Flash, is actually beating 4o Mini in here for MathVista. Another thing that is very interesting is that just like Haiku and Gemini Flash multimodal models that can do text and images, from today, basically 4o Mini supports the same thing, but it also looks like, just like Gemini Flash, that in the near future, they're also going to support video and audio inputs in here. So there's no talk that I see here of this having the audio outputs like the 4o model, which now has been delayed, giving people access to the 4o voices, etc. But it is cool that this looks like it's going to be 128,000K tokens. And I think one of the biggest factors here is this whole issue of 16,000 output tokens. So we know that most of the models are either 4,000 or 8,000 output tokens. So having this being able to output 16,000 output tokens at a time really is a useful kind of thing for doing a whole bunch of things where you want to perhaps do editing in and out. You want it to fix something up or rewrite something without summarizing it, but just focusing on changing certain words in the text and stuff like that. In the past, you've been limited for that kind of thing because if you wanted a one-for-one input to output, that you are really limited to perhaps 8K in, 8K out. The fact that this can do 16,000 output tokens is really a nice jump to see this going on in here. They mentioned that the knowledge is basically frozen up until October 2023. So my guess is this is not going to be an awesome model for doing things like just being able to write the latest code for things or know the latest docs for different things and stuff like that. You're going to have to basically inject those in the context window to be able to have the model use that kind of thing. Finally, another interesting thing in here is that this is using the same tokenizer from GPT-4o. If you think back to some videos that I've made quite a while back now, I pointed out that the GPT-3 models and GPT-4 model was very limited for multilingual in that even if you could do it, it was often charging you up to 12 times more because it needed so many sort of single letter tokens to represent some of these languages. Now that was fixed in GPT-4o. We still don't have a reason actually why they didn't call that 4.5. As I understood it, it was originally supposed to be called 4.5 and then perhaps didn't perform as well as they had expected. So they decided to call it 4.0. But it's good to see that this mini model also has that improved tokenizer, which means that the model can handle multilingual much better than the previous models could in here. So just finally looking at their mentions about the safety features, I found it interesting in here that they're talking a lot more now about that in pre-training, they are actually doing filtering out of information. This is definitely an aggressive step that you're not even allowing people to be able to realign this model in the future. There's a lot of information that's not even going into this. And while it's good that perhaps not to include things like hate speech and stuff like that, is there certain information that people would actually find quite debatable about whether it should be going in or shouldn't be going in there? For post-training, they've been extremely vague in here. They don't really talk about any of the other post-training stuff or any of the instruction fine-tuning. I haven't seen there be any talk of a technical paper or anything like that in here. So that would be nice if it comes, but my guess is that they're not going to really tell us much about this. So another thing that's interesting in here in regards to the safety stuff is that they talk about that this is the first model to apply our new sort of instruction hierarchy method, which helps to improve the model's ability to resist jailbreaks, prompt injections, and system prompt extractions. Now, they've released a paper for this. I will go through it. If I find it interesting enough, maybe I'll make a separate video about this. I do notice, though, that on Twitter, some of the people that are well known for jailbreaking models and stuff like that have claimed to crack it within the first few hours of doing this. So maybe it's not protected as well. I'm not going to actually show you what they have got it to manage to say and stuff like that, but certainly they've managed to get it to give drug recipes and a whole bunch of other stuff that you could imagine that OpenAI don't want people actually having out there. Finally, just to finish up before we jump in and have a look at some code and actually test out the model, it is a good point to reinforce one of the things that I've been saying recently about the cost of tokens. They mentioned that the cost per token of GPT-4o Mini has dropped by 99% compared with Text DaVinci 3. So if you remember Text DaVinci 3, one of the earlier sort of experiments in RLHF that was out there. And I feel that this does just reinforce the fact that these models are getting cheaper, faster, bigger context windows, all these kind of things are just becoming more and more. And you should be planning for that as you go ahead. This model definitely gets OpenAI into the game of these super cheap models, where it makes you start to wonder and question if you are only using open source for the cost. This really blows that out of the water. Now, of course, if you're still using open source models for privacy, for customization, for other things like that, it still makes a lot of sense. Anyway, let's jump into some code and have a play with the model and see how it actually performs. Okay, so I think it's no surprise that this model is going to be quite good. So going through the generations out here, it does really well for a lot of different things. It's got a few interesting characteristics. So first off, it also now has gone to the putting everything out in Markdown sort of style. So I think Gemini and Gemma were one of the first ones to do this. And a lot of the other open source models have gone this way as well. And there's a lot of sort of theory behind this. I think maybe at some point I make another video just about this. But the sort of thinking is that clearly they're doing post-training with fully annotated chain of thought and a number of different other kinds of things similar to chain of thought. And that works really well with Markdown. So you can see that when you basically ask it to do step by step, it really gives you out these sort of step by steps. Now, a lot of models are using this. This is not something that's unique to OpenAI or anything like that in particular. Another interesting thing here is in this one, it defines a taxonomy and then it goes for different things in here, like physical traits, habitat, uses, My guess is if I'd given it more tokens, it would have kept going with other things as well in there. Some other interesting things in here are the things like getting it to write an email. It definitely seems a lot more succinct and to the point than some of the previous OpenAI ones. So much so that like with this one here where I ask it to be the email from a child, it's just so short. And I was curious that like recently we had a model that sort of scattered emojis in there. So I was curious to see, okay, cool. If this doesn't give emojis, but if we ask for it, please include emojis, it has no problems putting in the emojis in there. So that's something, you know, nice to see in here. Although it's I think it was the intern LM model that was doing this. That was interesting in that the emojis were throughout the text rather than just not just at the end of the text, summarizing the text like this is done here. Again, if we ask it the whole sort of thing from the vice president, it adopts the tone quite nicely. I wouldn't necessarily say that this is the best one that I've seen like this, but it's certainly good. I also like how this can be very to the point. We ask it, okay, what's the capital of England? It comes back with London. When I ask it, if you can give a one-word answer, then do so. And it just gives London there. So that's, you know, really good. The chain of thought on the Geoffrey Hinton question is interesting in that it has different ways of categorizing these or classifying these. First, it's got temporal context, then a medium of conversation, then a metaphorical context. My guess is that those are coming from some of its fine-tuning, just how it's been fine-tuned with different post-training techniques. And it's learned to use these sorts of things and classify these sorts of things. The storytelling is really quite nice in here as well. Again, it's interesting to look at this and see what names it chooses and stuff like that. And we've seen some of those names in other models, which makes me wonder, are some of those people using OpenAI data for doing fine tuning? And that's why you end up getting some of these similar things. I haven't actually run this on the GPT-4o, so it would be interesting to see there. CodeGen, it does, you know, quite nicely. GSM-8K, it does quite nicely. I actually did another notebook of going through 100 different GSM-8K questions, and it seems to do very well on those. You can see all of these it gets right. So we've got the 9 apples, we've got the $10 perfectly rounded and stuff like that. Another interesting thing is it's giving LaTeX in here. Its chain of thought obviously uses LaTeX probably to try and improve the math and reasoning skills in here. When we ask about the deep sea monster, again, we've got a little bit of LaTeX in there, but it's really got the sort of idea of this down that we really want to get X, that we're going to have X, 2X, 4X. So that's going to be 7x, so 847 divided by 7. It's really maps it out nicely here to get that. And it can get that both as a word sort of puzzle and as a, just a mathematical thing in here. So that's something that's really nice. You can see that when we ask it for doing things without chain of thought, then it goes into much more of a sort of standard response in here. I guess there are probably a number of different sorts of styles of chain of thought or step-by-step thinking strategies, mental models, that kind of thing that they've trained into the model when they've done this. Okay, the React stuff, it seems to do fine on that. Lastly, just giving it some function calling stuff, it does well with the standard function calls, that kind of thing. Nothing's overly hard here. I did find this one kind of interesting is that here, even when I give it a function, and this is just like a mock function to basically get it to use a translator rather than translate itself, it decides that it doesn't need that. It's just going to translate itself and go through there. We can see that there is no function call or tool calls in there. Getting structured data out, here this does quite nicely. We basically have just defined, here it has no problems calling the function to basically get this data back in here. So I might look at doing some more stuff around function calling for agents, and I will definitely do some of that with this model as well. Anyway, overall, this is definitely a good model. And the fact that it's so cheap, this really hits the ball back in the court of sort of Google and Anthropic to come up with something that's either cheaper or better than this. Considering this is cheaper than both the Flash model and the Haiku model, it will be very interesting to see when Anthropic releases the Haiku 3.5. We know that's coming. They've said that's coming. with currently only the Sonnet 3.5 out. It's going to be interesting to see, is the Haiku 3.5 suddenly even better than this? Certainly, we're getting spoiled for models compared to, say, this time last year, when there wasn't a lot of choice out there. And I think the GPT-4o Mini really is starting to lead the pack at that sort of cheap model area. And I do wonder, going forward, is this the area that we're going to see most of the companies end up focusing on, rather than going for new super big models that are going to have a lot more intelligence? We may not see those models now until the end of this year, start of next year kind of thing coming out. Anyway, as always, if you've got any comments, anything that you noticed yourself playing with the model, please put it in the comments below. Any questions, put them there. If you found the video useful, please click like and subscribe, and I will talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.